Hello and welcome to the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics podcast series. The aim of this podcast series is to keep you up to date with the latest information from experts across the globe on all things home economics related. My name is Dr. Elaine Mooney and I am Director of the National Centre of Excellence for Home Economics at St. Angela's College in Sligo. On today's podcast, I am joined by Sinéad Curran, Dietician Manager at the National Maternity Hospital, Holly Street in Dublin, via Teams, to discuss the latest nutritional research pertaining to pregnancy. Sinéad has over 20 years' experience in dietetics, advising people on nutrition before, during and after pregnancy. Sinéad has participated in a range of published research examining mothers' nutrition and the impact on their babies. And she is a lecturer for the postgraduate dietitian students or dietitian students at UCD. Sinéad contributes to national guidelines, including the HSC National Clinical Guideline on Nutrition During Pregnancy. Thanks for joining me today, Sinéad.
Oh, I'm delighted to be here, Elaine.
Great. Sinéad, we can't possibly start this podcast without referring to the first 1,000 days, which, of course, is that critical period from conception to the child's second birthday.
Yes, indeed. And it's a fascinating thought, isn't it, that what our mothers ate could possibly have an impact on our health. But there's a growing body of evidence that a mother's nutritional well-being at the time of conception, that is when the egg and sperm unite, and how well nourished she is during pregnancy has a lasting impact on her baby's development. That first 1,000 days is a measure from conception up to 2 years of age, as you said. And research into what's known as the developmental origins of health and disease, it's referred to as DOHAD, D-O-H-A-D, is of interest across the world, from developing countries where women might be undernourished and need support to get enough energy and micronutrients, to, like ourselves, in developing countries where obesity and poor nutritional quality of mothers' diets are an issue as well. So it used to be known as the Barker hypothesis, after the scientist who first put it forward as a possibility that what nutrition babies had access to in pregnancy might impact on those babies' health as an adult. But it's gone on to be even more interesting and complex, I suppose, than it first seems.
And it's something that certainly the media are often, you see, referred to the first 1,000 days as being crucial.
Absolutely.
So I suppose, Sinéad, you know, often people have this, they get confused with the eating for two. But when we discuss just the kilocalorie recommendations, it's not really eating for two, is it, when it comes to the overall energy intake, Sinéad?
It's not really. And definitely, unless anybody's intending to have a good size 18-year-old at the end of a pregnancy, you're not eating for two adults for sure. So if you think about the scale of things, obviously it's not double the intake, but we often say it is an improved quality that's required. In terms of energy, though, women do need additional energy when they're pregnant, because there's an awful lot of energy required to manufacture the support elements of pregnancy. So typically, women need more towards the end of the pregnancy than towards the beginning. But the amount that any individual woman needs might depend on maybe her own body mass index at the start of pregnancy. So women who have a smaller body size at the start of pregnancy might need slightly more on average than somebody who's got a slightly larger body and might have some stores of energy. So usually we start off with, you know, an approximate energy intake that's slightly less than 100 calories a day at the start of pregnancy. The calculated requirement is up to as much as 500 additional calories a day at the end of pregnancy. There's very specific guidance on that per trimester in the National Clinical Guidelines. But the average throughout pregnancy, we would estimate at being about 300 additional calories a day from the second trimester on. People might not need anything at all extra in the first trimester.
Okay.
So again, the specific guidance for this on a per trimester basis in the National Clinical Guidelines, but it's definitely less at the beginning, more at the end, and an average of about 300 calories a day from the second trimester on.
That's brilliant, Sinéad. Will we move straight to the macronutrients and probably best to begin with protein?
Well, again, protein requirements, there are additional protein requirements. There is additional protein required, rather, in pregnancy. And again, we do kind of, most of these are based on sort of calculations and estimations.
Yes.
So while we would, say that people need slightly more, in reality, the majority of women's diets might be higher in protein than they would need. So the guidance says that for the first trimester, you need an additional 1 gram of protein. And in the second trimester, it's 9, and the third, and for lactation, it's 28. But really, people don't eat grams of protein. They eat servings of food, most typically. So usually what we recommend is that people might choose an extra 2 servings of protein-rich food from the food pyramid in this first and second trimester, and 2 in the first and second trimester, and 3, which is additional protein, in the third trimester.
Perfect. Okay. Right. And with regard to carbohydrates then, and maybe the different types of fiber?
That's a really good question, because I think sometimes that can cause a little bit of confusion as well. There's a lot of interest in very low carbohydrate diets as a tool for weight management at the moment. But there is a baseline minimum requirement for carbohydrate in pregnancy. It is the fuel of choice. Glucose is the fuel of choice for developing babies. So the recommended daily allowance, or the recommended daily intake, is 175 grams per day. And that's based on meeting that kind of base level minimum amount of glucose for normal function for both the mother and the baby's brain. And usually that, again, if you translate that into servings of food that contain carbohydrate, it's 3 servings of fruit, 2 servings of vegetables, 3 servings of milk or yogurt, and 3 servings of whole grains. And that variety, it spread, that carbohydrate being sourced from across that variety of foods, is a way of spreading the type and of fibre and the type of nutrients that might be associated with those foods. So the advice is to encourage a variety of whole grains, fruit, vegetables and legumes. And those legumes, starchy beans, lentils, pulses, and then also nuts and seeds, are really important to help meet the fibre requirement. Okay. So it is a very important nutrient that oftentimes people are trying to minimise, but there is a base minimum requirement.
Mm-hmm. And I suppose the same could be said for the fats.
Oh, yes, indeed. Yeah, very good. And again, fat as well. You know, things go, and, you know, anyone who is even within stalking distance of social media knows that fashions come and go, and nutrition is very much subject to them. And women in particular are a target for messages via social media, because marketing messages are very successful in that format. So diet goes in fashion, and nutrition goes in fashion. And sometimes there is an emphasis, a greater or lesser emphasis on certain things. It's all low carb now. I'm around long enough to remember when it was all about low fat. But a lot of times people, yes, we're showing our age, but a lot of times people, I mean, this, the examples, the low carbs would be the Atkins style, the ketogenic diet now, Scarsdale is the old one, mm-hmm. but the very low fat diets that you and I would remember, was this Rosemary Conley's hip and pie diet, there was people on like egg and grapefruit diets, which were really, really low fat diets. Obviously none of that is recommended in pregnancy. No. It's not really all that useful outside of pregnancy. But there is, again, the intake around fat, again, which can be seen as a negative thing, is really focused on the quality, again, of the diet. So while everybody in the country should be minimizing their intake of saturated fats, so pregnant women, the same as for anybody else, follow the National Health Eating Guidelines. They're applicable to pregnant women in relation to fat intake. So you minimize saturated fats. So that's fats from, the fat that you'd see on beef or pork or that kind of thing is typically saturated fat. But fat is complicated. It's not always just entirely one form of fat. It's not going to be 100% saturated fat, maybe in dairy food, dairy or animal products. And a more problematic one in terms of heart disease certainly is trans fats. And trans fatty acids are what you get when oils, things that are naturally in oil at a room temperature, is heated to make it a solid at a room temperature. It changes the nature of it, and that doesn't go so well in terms of human diets for risk of heart disease and other illness. So there is a guideline to kind of minimize the intake of trans fats, and that's in line with healthy eating recommendations. So you'd be minimizing the intakes of trans fatty acids by avoiding, fried foods, baked goods. So the usual suspects, your donuts, cakes, pies, biscuits, pastries. And people often think that that's because of the sugar content, but really it's more to do with the trans fats. So there's a positive recommendation, and this is what we much, much, much prefer to emphasize. Again, we emphasize quality, we emphasize, foods rather than individual nutrients. There's a positive recommendation to make sure that that we recommend that women include enough omega-3 fatty acids, and particularly the DHA component of omega-3 fatty acids, because that is associated very positively with fetal brain development and with eye development, the retina as well. So there's a mixture of evidence regarding the effectiveness case of supplementation, but we know that a good intake, a good intake of DHA, so that component of omega-3 fatty acids from foodstuffs, is positively associated with fetal development, with baby's development. So the recommendation there then to get that would be ideally 1 to 2 servings of oily fish per week, whether you're pregnant or not pregnant, but it's especially important for the DHA when somebody is pregnant. So oily fish being your salmon, trout, mackerel, herring, sardines, if somebody likes those, it's very easy to achieve. But again, that advice can get a little bit mixed up with people trying to avoid things because of food safety. But it is very clear that 1 to 2 servings is not going to exceed anything that might be problematic in terms of oily fish, and it will meet the requirements for those very important, useful, essential fatty acids.
Okay. And I suppose, Sinéad, you know, the other nutrients, while they're micronutrients, we are very mindful of them as well, and that would be the calcium and the vitamin D.
Yes, and those two together, and again, most women will be aware of the role of calcium in a healthy diet as being important for bone health. So there's a specific recommendation that women should be advised to eat enough calcium-rich foods to achieve an intake of about 1,000 milligrams a day. That amounts to 3 servings of milk, yogurt, cheese, or fortified plant-based alternatives. And increasingly, with increasing numbers of people are following plant-based diets, so it's a really important recommendation that people should use fortified plant-based alternatives, because those foods are naturally rich in both calcium and iodine, the dairy foods from animal sources, but the plant-based alternatives are not naturally rich in those sources. So calcium, again, Irish diets would have a large component of these dairy foods in them, and it's quite easy to achieve that calcium intake if people remember to have 3 servings. So like milk on your cereal in the morning, a yogurt mid-morning, and cheese and crackers in the evening time is going to achieve that 1,000 milligrams. But alongside that, the vitamin D requirement is a little bit harder to meet.
Yes.
And this is because, you know, I mean, again, anybody listening to this podcast will be aware that the majority of your vitamin D comes through the action of sunlight, the UVB rays on skin. So it is, vitamin D is really a hormone that's activated by UVB rays on acting on skin, and cholesterol has a role to play in that. There's a whole load of very interesting kind of nutritional processes that are involved in that. But we'll also be aware, living in Ireland, that sunlight is not that easy to come by, particularly between October and March. So there is a guideline that everybody in the country should take a vitamin D supplement daily, and the recommendation in pregnancy that's included in our national guidelines is for 10 micrograms of vitamin D daily. Now again, that's 400 international units. The bane of all our lives is that in nutrition science is that we sometimes flick between one unit to another unit to describe things. So we usually stick with the 10 micrograms as the easy one to remember. Now, up to 25 is fine, but it's okay. 10 micrograms is the recommendation in the guideline. And again, ideally from food, but the food, it's fortified milk and oily fish would be the main sources there. And that is to account for the fact that sunlight, whether, you know, it's because of cloud cover, we're too far north, we're in the same latitude as Helsinki and Moscow, but we don't think of ourselves as being as northerly as that. You know, so the amount of UVB rays that you get this far north in the winter time is compromised by our latitude. So the 10 micrograms of vitamin D is recommended as a supplement, but food sources are also important.
Yes, and Sinéad, we all know about the importance of folic acid prior to conception, you know, to protect the baby from developing neural tube defects. But what about during pregnancy?
That's a really interesting question now, because I think you say we all, and that's probably people of our age who maybe have had children or have been aware of it, but we see about 50% of women presenting pregnant for the first time won't have been taking a folic acid supplement prior to pregnancy. And the guideline is that every woman should have 400 micrograms, or every person that might become pregnant should have 400 micrograms of folic acid daily, and this is a background kind of a population based health recommendation to help make sure that folic acid is on board at the start of pregnancy should somebody become pregnant. Now, it's not just for that, because folic acid has a key role in red blood cell manufacture, and the way that I always describe it in classes and in clinics is it's a little bit like your printer ink or your toner in your photocopier. Folic acid helps every replicating cell to replicate properly. So if you think about the effect of the, you know, when the printer ink is getting, the quality getting low, the quality of the copy starts to reduce. And the same is true of inadequate folic acid. The same is true of the cells that are rapidly dividing. The copies that they're making of themselves might not be as robust. And one of the times for a very high demand of folic acid is during times of growth and development. So throughout pregnancy, both the mother and the baby have a demand for folic acid for that reason. So we recommend now that people continue folic acid throughout pregnancy. And in fact, it's really a woman's health vitamin that ideally you'd be taking every day as routine part of vitamin supplementation. The importance of it in at the start of pregnancy is about the neural tube defects, and about 70% of neural tube defects, spina bifida, hydrocephalus and encephaly, can be prevented through adequate red cell folate, having enough folate present at the time that that neural tube is starting to develop to make sure that it rolls and folds properly and goes on to develop into the fully formed brain and spinal cord. You know, those neural tube defects are due to gaps in that development, but that development starts at about 5 or 6 weeks gestation, and that's around the time when somebody's just doing a pregnancy test.
Yes.
So the advice to continue it is not to do with the neural tube defects. That business is done really by the preconception folic acid. The advice to continue folic acid is new, relatively new advice. I mean, this is, it's not today nor yesterday, but it's within the last few years, and it's because it has a role for red blood cells and for making sure that all rapidly dividing cells can be robust.
Brilliant. And we might as well look at iron and vitamin C together as well.
True, and another really good combination. Iron, about a third of women won't have adequate iron in their diets. So the recommendation is that women should get 16 to 20 milligrams of iron in addition to iron from a balanced diet. That has the potential to reduce the incidence of anemia in a healthy population. But we know about a third of women don't have enough iron in their diets to begin with. And this is more so, you know, where women have maybe had previous pregnancies. You donate a substantial amount of iron to the firstborn gets the best of you, but you donate a substantial amount of iron during the course of pregnancy. And again, no baby is born without some kind of blood loss. But if anybody has, you know, heavy periods, or is a little bit older and has had more periods prior to getting pregnant, or has a high BMI, or maybe had pregnancy losses prior to the pregnancy, they typically will need more than that to achieve the amount of iron that you need to support a healthy pregnancy development. So we do recommend additional iron where women have risk of anemia, but the guideline is for 16 to 20 milligrams of iron. That's about the amount that's in a pregnancy multivitamin. So when people do need supplementation to either prevent or treat iron deficiency anemia, it's 100 to 200 milligrams per day as a supplement, as an elemental iron. And that is this fairly well-known, any of the standard well-known tablets, as Galfer is one of them, Ferrigrad C is another. There's a range of them that will contain that amount of iron, just in a slightly different version. And a lot of times women are recommended to take those, you know, if they've those risk factors for anemia in advance of getting a low blood count, because prevention usually works much better than trying to treat it. It's hard to pull it up out of your boots, but if you can stop it from falling, that usually works well. The food sources are very important, though.
And the vitamin C too.
Oh, yes. And that's the key thing. Vitamin C for the absorption. And again, we find time and again that we're back to diet first always. So I'm talking about the nutrients, I suppose. And when we talk about the nutrients, you think about them in isolation in the supplements, but the food sources combined with food sources of vitamin C. So your main food sources for heme iron, and that's the difference again between the heme and the non-heme, is important to point out. And we have a lovely chart that just shows you exactly, you know, that while you might have, if you look at your portion of spinach and your portion of red meat, they might contain similar amounts of iron, but the bioavailability of the heme iron in the meat multiplies by 9 the usefulness of it in terms of the total iron that you'll be able to get from it. So it's back to again the usual suspects, your beef, your lamb. You'll get some from chicken breast is not particularly rich, but is a source of iron. Dark fish like salmon, tin sardines, all of those in combination then with something that contains vitamin C, because the vitamin C helps promote an acidic environment and is a cofactor for the absorption of iron. So your vitamin C rich foods might be your tomatoes, for instance, so having a fresh salad alongside the iron-rich source will improve the absorption of it. And this is especially important, again, in plant-based diets where people don't use the heme iron sources. So your non-heme iron sources in plant-based diets would chiefly be your legumes, so beans or fortified foods, again, are get to be very important. Baked beans are a reasonable source of iron, but again, because they're non-heme, the tomato-based sauce is quite useful there to help that absorption. So yes, combinations of food usually help.
Yeah, I suppose we know there are loads of other minerals and trace elements like the magnesium and copper and zinc, Sinéad, but I suppose I'm particularly interested in the research around iodine. Yeah. Is there any new evidence there?
This is a really interesting one. And a couple of things came out about iodine in recent years. We would have known for a long time that iodine is a key element in fetal brain development. And there's a condition called cretinism that is on foot of maternal iodine that happens. It's a developmental disorder, so developmental delay, it's a cognitive impairment, and you'll be familiar with the word cretin, but it is a particular condition that is on foot of inadequate iron in the course of development in the womb. So it's very important. This is spectrum then, there aren't, that's the extreme end of it. So where you see that in countries maybe where there's very little iodine in the soil, so there's very little iodine in the food chain. So countries that are in the middle of a big continent like Africa, that are very far from the sea, will have a low quality of iodine or low quotient of iodine in the soil, so therefore iodine doesn't enter the food chain. In Ireland, the main sources of iodine in Irish diets are actually milk and yogurt. And whitefish is a good source of iodine, but it is very important in maternal diets because of that brain development. And there is some interesting research around cognitive development and iodine on the kind of upper end of it. So, you know, IQ points now, IQ, you know, whether that's a useful measurement of people's capacity or not. But it is, there's some interesting research around that women who have adequate iodine intakes seem to add to cognitive development or to aid cognitive development because it has such a key role in brain development. Iodine is also important for thyroid development, and thyroid is the centre of operations really in terms of regulating metabolism. So anybody who has had a thyroid issue will know that they're not meant to take extra iodine as a supplement, and that is true in pregnancy as well. So, but you should be getting adequate iodine from diet. So those sources, whitefish, dairy foods, they're important for the calcium, and if they're fortified, also for the vitamin D. But iodine is very important for thyroid hormones and for fetal brain development. And there was research, it was interesting, it was a change in farming practices that were shown to have reduced iodine levels. So for instance, they used to use povidine iodine to clean milking machines and to clean the teats for cattle, and that introduced iodine into the food chain, which was actually ultimately beneficial. But they had to regulate that just to make sure that skim milk powder didn't contain excess iodine, and it resulted in a reduction in iodine. So we do recommend it in the multivitamins. But it's a very interesting one. Lots of micronutrients like that are of interest, but iodine, because of those changes in the intake in the population, is something that we emphasize again in pregnancy.
Okay, and I suppose mentioning vitamin A and the whole thing of avoiding liver.
Oh yes, and that's another really, really good question, really useful question. Food avoidance is something that causes a lot of concern, I think, when people are newly pregnant in particular. So vitamin A is a known teratogen, so that means it can cause harm to baby's development in the early weeks of pregnancy in particular. Now the safe upper limit is actually much higher than you would think, but we don't recommend that people consume foods that are naturally very rich in vitamin A. So that would be liver, pate, and again, supplements though are much more likely to be the culprit. So anybody who's kind of, you know, as people who are very interested in their health, sometimes they might be taking lots of extra supplements, and they might end up taking supplements that have a high vitamin A as retinol. So that's the important thing, that it's the retinol that's problematic. You get vitamin A as beta carotene, which is the precursor for it, in any vegetables and fruits that look kind of have a red yellow color. And like the most significant downside to taking extra beta carotene really is that your palms, your hands might go a little bit yellow, or you might get a kind of a jaundiced look about you. But that's not problematic in pregnancy. So pregnancy supplements that are designed for pregnancy will typically use beta carotene in preference to vitamin A, because you won't make retinol rather out of the beta carotene if you've got enough already in your system. But it is important to avoid foods that might have a very high concentration of vitamin A for that reason, that it can be problematic in the first trimester.
Okay, and I know some of the latest evidence with regard to brain development is kind of novel or new, Sinéad, so perhaps you might update us on the latest with regard to that.
Well, were you thinking of anything in particular?
Yeah, I was thinking about choline, I suppose.
Oh, choline. Choline is an interesting one. And I suppose this is sort of information that's been around for quite a while. Choline is very similar to folic acid in that it's a kind of, it works in a similar way. And choline, it is... Like, it's easy to have enough choline in your diet if you eat a mixed diet. It's it is rich, foods that are rich in protein are rich in choline. But again, some people, especially women who are sick maybe, or people who are eating very limited diets, might be avoiding things like dairy foods or eggs. Choline, eggs are particularly rich in choline. Because it works in a similar way to folic acid, too little choline. Now, we don't see it that often. It's interesting, but we don't see it in practice because most people eat mixed diets, eat sufficient diets. So it's one of those things that we don't necessarily recommend that people need to take extra of, but it is one of the reasons why maybe diets that are too low in protein or don't have a good variety of foods in them might be problematic. Choline might be one of the reasons why that's an issue. And again, very similar to folic acid. Really interesting research around that. But it's we can look at any one nutrient and find many, many reasons why it's good. But that's research goes in phases and fashions in terms of what we're able to do as well. So you'll see a lot sometimes of information on various different individual nutrients. And when we bring it back, though, to what we're recommending that people eat, it looks still very much like what you might term a Mediterranean style diet with plenty of whole grains, because that's good for your gut bacteria. Again, there's a lot of interest in pre and probiotics now at the moment, and a lot of research going on with those and the impact on those in terms of actual gut function and then the baby's growth and development subsequently, because you pick up your microbiome from your mother in the process of being born. So, you're sterile in the womb and then pass through the birth canal with a view to picking up things from your mum that's meant to happen. Yes. So being impacted by what you eat is a really interesting area of research. Always more to be found out about these things, I think.
Yes, because it's new, I suppose. In terms of you mentioned there about sickness and morning sickness, perhaps you might be able just to say a little bit about, like meal planning guidelines that you might think about if you were suffering with morning sickness.
Another really good question, Elaine, because again, it's quite common that people will suffer. There's a spectrum of it, really, I suppose. And we often describe for women, again, which they can relate to very well, that they'll go from being hungry to being hangry to being sick quite quickly when they're pregnant. And that's because of that demand for glucose. So if your blood glucose kind of, if you draw on your blood glucose, you can feel quite unwell very suddenly. And that happens a lot during pregnancy. So you will go from being fed to being starved in a biological sense very quickly when you're pregnant, because there's so many draws on your glucose requirement. But when people have that I suppose people that are very sick with it hate the term morning sickness, because there is an extreme version of nausea and vomiting in pregnancy that's called hyperemesis. And now that affects between 1-3%. We probably underdiagnose it a little bit, but that's that is vomiting, 15 to 20 times in the day, not being able to maintain any degree of meaningful food intake, not being able to maintain your hydration. That's quite a severe thing. And we treat that as a medical complication of pregnancy, and we have a very specific kind of approach to that. For people that are suffering from anything like that kind of queasiness, regular queasiness, up to vomiting maybe in the morning time or a couple of times in the day, or really not feeling terribly well during the course of the day, the best course of action is to make sure that you're eating regularly. So eating regularly, whether that was your usual pattern of eating or not, is really recommended. So usually something to eat within an hour of being awake in the morning. And again, the emphasis is typically on carbohydrate rich foods, because that helps to settle that kind of glucose requirement. Small portions, really often the real, the old the typical traditional wannabe crackers before your breakfast, before you get out of bed in the morning time, but anything that mimics that simple carbohydrate. So it's not looking for your whole grain carbohydrate, looking for something that'll digest quite quickly, settle your stomach, and then hopefully moving on. Alongside that, staying hydrated is very important. So we'll often recommend that people, maybe if they're struggling to drink, you don't need to drink water to stay hydrated. About a third of your fluid requirements will come from the food that you eat. So if you're able to eat foods that have a high water content, that can be really helpful if you're suffering from nausea and vomiting in pregnancy. Things like watermelon maybe, or grapes, so fruit of any kind. But again, particularly ice lollies, things like that, that yes. might help. And to spread that out nice and evenly over the course of the day, don't worry so much about healthy eating guidelines in the first trimester, because really when the interplay between maternal diets, the first trimester is much more related to what you're eating before you were pregnant.
Yes.
Because it's almost like the baby sources nutrients locally in the first trimester, whereas what a woman is eating and what appears in her bloodstream and is available to cross the placenta to her baby is a much stronger relationship between what the baby gets from mother's diet once the placenta is up and running from the second trimester on. So we don't worry so much about the quality if somebody's sick in the first trimester, as long as they're able to get calories and glucose and fluids, because that helps keep the show on the road.
And while you're speaking about fluids, what about caffeine, Sinéad?
Yes, another really good question. There is a recommendation to minimise. Caffeine does cross the placenta. So if you think about yourself, if you have a strong cup of coffee and you can feel your heart rate going, you can imagine the scale of that as a stimulus on a developing baby, the size that they are. So it does cross the placenta and it is a stimulant. So there is a recommendation that women should keep their caffeine intake on the low side. It's we say it's mildly addictive, but people will say they can't function without their coffee in the morning. But it is present in a range of foods, I suppose, caffeine, but the chief ones would be coffee and tea. Now tea is nowhere near as strong as your coffee would be, but it's also in things like cocoa and chocolate and soft drinks. And a big thing for us at the moment is these energy drinks, which there's a lot of interest in them with young people in particular, and they tend to be very high in caffeine. We just recommend that people kind of keep their caffeine intake to about 200 milligrams a day. But again, people need to know that looks like between two and four cups of tea or two cups of instant coffee. We give the recommendation to people in terms of food rather than in terms of milligrams of
yes,
the nutrient, because it's easier to visualize.
Yes. And am I correct in saying, Sinéad, speaking about foods to avoid, that you don't actually need to avoid peanuts in pregnancy?
That's another great question, Elaine, because this is one of those, it's really hard and it's a problem with public health generally. If you put a piece of information out there, it's really hard to draw it back. And yet it seems to be extremely hard to get a proper piece of information out there in the first place. The information on peanuts changed. We know a lot more, I suppose, about allergy and the origins, again, of things in the womb. And it doesn't seem to make any difference whether people eat peanuts in pregnancy or not. It does not cause allergy. In fact, no foods that you eat during pregnancy are going to be associated with the baby developing an allergy to that food. And it is likely that getting a broken version of those proteins, or exposure to a filtered broken version of those proteins through a mother's body, might be protective against allergy. But what we know is most certainly protective against allergy is breast milk in the gut. So babies getting any breast milk helps the gut to develop in such a way that it protects it and makes it the immune system then manage the response to proteins in diet appropriately, and not to have an overreaction to them, which is what an allergy is.
Yes.
So introducing foods alongside breast milk is really helpful to reduce the risk of allergy.
Okay, and I suppose there are still, though, Sinéad, a number of limited foods that we would be still avoiding. I'm just thinking of the unpasteurised dairy now, for example.
That's absolutely correct. And there's two reasons, really. One is food safety with regards to bacteria or organisms that could be problematic, foodborne illness or organisms that could be problematic if the toxins from them cross the placenta to the baby. So some bacteria or organisms can produce toxins that are developmentally problematic for babies. And the chief among those would be Salmonella, Listeria and Toxoplasma. So Listeria is the one that's associated with things like cured meats or smoked salmon. So smoked fish, smoked meats, they haven't been cooked. And Listeria can grow on those foods. So we usually recommend that people avoid foods that of that nature, foods that have been cured. And smoked salmon is a prime example in an Irish context, anyway, in an Irish setting.
Yes.
But also that it can be, other foods that can be a vector for Listeria would include mould-ripened cheese. So this is where you'll see the advice, and it can get a little bit confusing. It's not about soft pasteurised cheeses like the brand names that might come in a tub that you'd spread. Mm-hmm. Those spreadable cheeses are absolutely fine. They're pasteurized and they're not mold ripened. You're talking about things like brie and camembert and blue cheese. Now, again, foods don't come labeled will contain Listeria. They may contain Listeria. Yes. And we recommend that people avoid them for that reason. But the good news is that it is destroyed by heat. The other two, Salmonella is strongly associated with eggs, and this is where like a high proportion of eggs will be contaminated with Salmonella, but we don't see these situations in pregnancy frequently because heat and cooking destroys the bacteria that could be problematic. So Salmonella, the advice is to avoid raw or partly cooked eggs or dishes containing part cooked eggs. And this is a really useful thing, again, in home economics. It's one of the reasons around food safety why you might just double check if somebody is pregnant or not, if you're serving a dish that contains eggs, or if you're using raw eggs, you might want to avoid, you might want to advise somebody that it's not suitable for women who are pregnant. But heating does destroy Salmonella. And then raw meat can contain toxoplasmosis. And again, we recommend in pregnancy that women should eat meat that's cooked well. Now that's kind of up to a temperature of 70 degrees, which is pasteurization temperature. So that might be that the meat is cooked to a medium well, and that, again, all the things that you would do to prevent cross-contamination are very important when it comes to meat because of that toxoplasmosis. Yes. So they're the main ones. Yes. And food preparation, again, just that, you know, the good technique with regard to storing and food preparation and chopping boards. And like, there's very good reasons why those are important at any time, but they're especially important because if a woman comes across those bacteria for the first time when she's pregnant, the toxins can be problematic for the baby.
Okay. And I know one other thing just to briefly mention before we finish up, Sinéad, in other countries they're stricter on it, and that is alcohol consumption during pregnancy.
Yes, indeed. Now, again, this is, we just in Ireland have, we don't receive messages around alcohol terribly well.
Well, okay.
You know, so it's just, again, the recommendation really is none. That's yes. the in the guideline, that the best is none. There is a spectrum. And we don't know which babies or which mothers are going to have an issue with this. You know, there's a spectrum of what we call fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. So, you know, there is fetal alcohol harm that is a very recognisable syndrome that results in developmental delay and the physical features that are very clearly associated with fetal alcohol exposure. So that's quite, you know, either binge drinking or, you know, high levels of alcohol exposure during pregnancy. But there's a spectrum of that disorder. Now, it's likely that very small amounts of alcohol do no harm whatsoever. But this, I suppose, there's no way in a guideline that's a population-based guideline. We can only say that we definitely know that none is no harm, but it's unlikely that moderate amounts are problematic. But you're talking about like really what would be very small occasional intake, so people needn't be worried about things like, you know, that we get phone calls sometimes, people are worried about those you know, they've eaten liqueurs, they've had alcohol in a dessert. Those things are absolutely not an issue. We know that absolutely high intakes of alcohol in pregnancy, even if it's just if it's infrequent, are problematic, but we've no way of knowing after that. So the guideline, unfortunately, really is none. But we're not encouraging people to be overly concerned about occasional exposure to alcohol in small amounts throughout pregnancy. It's very unlikely to be a problem.
Thank you so much, Sinéad, for joining me today and for updating us on the latest evidence-based research pertaining to healthy eating during pregnancy. And also thank you to the listeners for tuning in. You have been listening to the Home Economics podcast brought to you by the Centre of Excellence at St. Angela's College. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.